most of my life, I thought that what really mattered for me was my effectiveness, not my motivation. I took my motivation for granted, but what really mattered was the difference I could make, my effectiveness out there. But over time I've come to see that you can't tell how effective you are. That we are so interwoven, and the particularly strong in this are the Buddhist teachers, Thich Nhat Hanh and the Buddha and all the others, about how we are so interwoven, and also systems thinkers talking about using metaphors of the neural net to understand an ecology, understanding of this relational world, that we're so, you don't know what the results are, the consequences from something that you've done or said. How it's affected somebody, how it was got translated into thoughts that they had and actions they took in their relations with other people. Or you could just think about someone who made a difference in your life, who opened a door, who inspired you. It could be somebody who wasn't even alive when that thought hit you. Do the people who affected your life know it? Chances are they don't. So then, we're too interwoven in the web of life to be able to trace what the results of are of the things that we put our heart and mind and hand to. The relationships, a word in passing, something that was said that I overheard, you just don't know. So now I realize that what it does depend on is my motivation, whether I give a darn or not, whether I care. I always took that for granted, as I said, but then I realized that if I lose that caring, then how do I get it back? It's sort of like that part in the Gospels where Jesus says, if you lose the salt, wherewith will be the food be seasoned if you lose the salt, if you lose the caring. Oh, so it's just turned for me, and it's been liberating, because this world is so uncertain. I can't count, I don't know. I literally don't know at all, and I think probably you don't either. Is it gonna be the great unraveling or the great turning that will be the denouement of this chapter of our human story? But there's one thing you can count on, and you can count on your intention. You can count on your motivation. You can count on your bodhicitta. And then I realized this sort of, that's something you can kind of rest into, like a kind of vehicle. So let me say a little bit about the guidelines that help me, and that they're woven into the word, the work that reconnect. And I'd say there are five of them. I like to make rules of five because then I can count them on one hand. And the first is, is to come from gratitude. Even no matter how dark or dim things are, or how I'm feeling, or whether I'm fed up or bored or impatient or pissed off, you know, you can choose. Always again, that choice, you can choose at one point to just be glad you're there. To remember that you've been given life. Now what helps me there always is signs of life in me, and one, I have a great friend in the breath. You know, Buddhist boy, they really go to town with the breath. Anapanasana and mindfulness of breathing in and breathing out, but there's nobody in this room who isn't breathing right now. And that breath is keeping you alive, moment by moment. So just try this for a minute. So you just sit there and don't slump in your chair, so try to let your spinal column rise right straight up from the dish of your pelvis. And exhale and relax your shoulders. Feel how sweetly you're held to the earth. And we're all kind of damp and sweating. Yeah, but realize if I'm dripping with sweat, you probably are too. So that's the thing we have in common right now, really being pleasantly cooked and simmered. And and I put your attention on the breath. So any sensations that accompany it could be the air in the nasal passages, it could be the touch of the breath on your upper lip, it could be the filling of the chest, it could be the rise or fall of the abdomen, and you just get fascinated. So this is the basic practice that the Buddha taught, anapanasati, mindfulness of breathing in and breathing out. Now, look, do you see anywhere in that flow of experience a point where you decide to breathe in or decide to breathe out? It seems to be happening of its own volition, doesn't it? It's really quite like we're being breathed. You are being breathed by life, as is the person on either side of you, and in front of you and back of you, as is actually everyone in London right now, and everyone in the Northern Hemisphere, and the trees, and the fishes in the sea, and the birds in the air, and this whole planetary web of life being breathed by life. And you, like me, are a moment by moment recipient of that gift of being breathed. So that's not only a reminder of being breathed into life, I can come from gratitude that I'm given the gift of life. I don't have to like everything, but I can be alive. And when I choose to let that be real for me, you know what that is? That's a revolutionary act. It is subversive to the capitalist system. We don't look right, we don't smell right, we don't drive right, we don't dress right. And we are planted with this craving in us that totally is where the late capitalism wants us to be, dependent on shopping and spending and comparing. So, this come from gratitude is a potent teaching. And the other one teaching that we have, and Karen here was mentioning it just a few minutes ago, is don't be afraid of the dark. And by that I mean not just when you trim down the lights so your electric bill or you cannot generate so much, but the darkness of the anguish, the darkness of the grief, the darkness of the dread, of the anger too, and the not knowing. Because this is a dark time, and we can learn to be with it, and sort of like that wonderful old song by Simon and Garfunkel, remember, "Hello darkness, my old friend, I've come to be with you again." or a poem by Rilke, you know, darkness, from whom I come, always with me, the room, you make more room around me than the light that only illumines what it encloses. So we learn in this work not to be afraid of our pain. You don't have to like it. You don't have to wallow in it. But don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of the world's pain or of your own. Because you realize then that what you're learning as you open to what's happening to your brothers, sisters of all species on this planet and the future ones, what's happening to them, is that you are learning to feel that, to not dismiss it, do not pathologize it, do not reduce it to some personal neurosis. Boy, did the pharmaceuticals want you to do that. So that's liberating too, is that you can embrace, and that's the sign of the Bodhisattva, the boundless, boundless heart. And if you learn, okay, I'm suffering with my world, that's good news, you know, because that means to suffer with is the literal meaning of compassion, that you're a compassionate one. And you feel pain for our world, that's the most healthy, normal thing. And it's also just the other side of love. Our pain for the world and our love for the world are like our two sides of the same coin. And when you learn how to not be afraid of the suffering, then, my friends, nothing can stop you. And then another thing we learn in the work that reconnects is to glimpse a vision. And it helps to do it together. To see what it would be like to have the rivers, the dams taken off the rivers. We're doing that in some rivers in Northern California. Just to imagine that. To imagine what it'd be like to have a place for the salmon to come up, to be able for the waters run free. And you nurture that kind of vision in yourself, and you can feel a kind of vitalization in your own body and psyche. And then you link arms. That's number four. You link arms because whatever it is it's about, don't try to do it alone. This is absolutely not the time for the lonely cowboy ego. This is absolutely the time for us to adventure together. Frodo needed his friends, and so do we. So there's so many games and so many ways of visioning together and plotting and planning together, but I come to the last teaching, which is for this time. It's really important to act your age. Now, whether you count that as the age of the planet, which would be 4 billion years, or the age of the universe, 13.7 billion years, that is how old you are. Science is telling us this. The new cosmology is telling us this. That there's every particle and every atom and every molecule and every cell of our body goes back to the forming of the galaxies. You are that old. So I'm going to give you an exercise right now, a hand meditation, and it's sort of more fun to do it if you use somebody else's hand. If you're very shy, you can use your own hand, but you can use somebody else's hand and let them on the other side of you use your hand. But The point of this is to contemplate a hand. And you can use your own, as I said, if you want. But now at just, you can sort of imagine that you're on a research mission from outer space. And you come to this planet and you really want to understand the dominant species here right at the moment. And you look at this appendage and you can see in this so much about the miracle and magic of life. Now, first of all, you notice all the little bones so delicately hinged. Get a load of that. Wow, and all the musculature. And now notice how the shell and padding, the carapace, has long since fallen away. So that this hand is an object for not only manipulating, but knowing its world. Because there's this soft, sensitive padding. Get a load of that. On the fingertips, the palm. But the price of that knowing, the price of connection, is vulnerability. So now this is a very vulnerable appendage, very easy to break, to burn, to crush, to irradiate. And this is the story of the evolution of life. As we grow in complexity, we become more vulnerable. We grow these soft, sensitive protuberances. Lips, ears, tongue. But back to the hand. Now you can take an evolutionary view of this hand and see that it is shaped by an unbroken series of adventures through the eons of time. That this was, they say, a fin in the mother seas where life took form. And all the adventures that happened like that unfolded without a break, and each one shaped this hand, made it more dexterous, more pliable, learning, pushing its way up on land, learning to reach, to grasp, to climb. Oh, look at this. See, now look at that thumb. Now it can touch the fingertips. Get a load of that. And see that opening? That's just the right size to grasp a branch strong enough to hold the weight. That's a gift from your grandmother once. And then, the long eons as we learn to not walk on this hand, but reach it with it up on 2 feet, and we manipulate our world, and we can take reeds and weave them together into baskets, and we can take seeds and plant them. We can take stones and chip them into tools. All of that is in this hand. You learn to see it in the hand. It is there. It shaped it. Making fire. Carrying the fire through the long ages of ice on the long journeys and pilgrimages. It's in that hand. Settling down and growing food. Building granaries and temples. Learning to trade, learning to write. Open heart surgery, it's all in that hand. Human hand, planet Earth. You know you could be anywhere, just close your eyes for a moment and feel that hand. You could be anywhere in the universe. You know you were home. They only make it here. That's only made in Earth, that's true. I checked it out. Yeah, and you can open your awareness to the story of this hand in this lifetime, ever since it opened like a flower as it came out of the mother's womb. clever hand that learned so much. Learned to reach for breast or bottle. Learned to hold a spoon. Learned to throw a ball. Learned to wipe tears. Learned to give pleasure. You know that there are people living now who believe that they're worthwhile because of what this hand has told them. People you may never know, but for a moment as you look at that hand, you're connecting with these people. And you know that there are people living now who may go into their dying, knowing that they're not abandoned because this hand will be their last touch in this life. And you know that there are people who will be guided through the dark, challenging times of the great turning, and the great unraveling and the great turning, because this hand will give them companionship and courage and guidance. So just give any last messages of appreciation. It's real. You're not inventing it. It's a real hand.
Class two.